Hey everybody, I don't know about you, but as you've watched out over the world, the war in Russia and Ukraine is not just isolated to Eastern Europe. It's spread all over the world, and you can see it in market instabilities. You can see it here. People who do not think that that war is affecting you, all you got to do is look at gas prices. You look at your food prices. You see the global change that has happened. But you know something that's also affected investments as well. And I've said all along, legacy precious metals is your navigator. They're the ones that see you through to get to the next level. The good news about this is even with market volatility, market instability, you've got options. And gold prices are rising as investors turn to gold. And gold presents a hedge against this inflation and that protects you against the weakening dollar, which we are seeing. Legacy Precious Metals is the only company I trust to deal with gold and silver and the other precious metals. You need this investment. You need this as part of your portfolio to keep you buffered from what we're seeing in the world, war and volatility in the market. This is where you need to be. Call Legacy Precious Metals today. Be proactive about this. Get on board with it. Call them at 866-528-1903, 866-528-1903, or you can download their free investor's guide at legacypminvestments.com, legacypminvestments.com, your navigator in a volatile world of investments.
Do you want to listen to a podcast?
By who?
Georgia GOP Congressman Doug Collins.
How is it?
The greatest thing I have ever heard in my whole life.
I could not believe my ears.
This house, wherever the rules are disregarded, chaos and mob rule. It has been said today, where is bravery? I'll tell you where bravery is found and courage is found. It's found in this minority who has lived through the last year of nothing but rules being broken, people being put down, questions not being answered, and this majority saying, be damned with anything else. We're going to impeach and do whatever we want to do. Why? Because we won an election. I guarantee you, one day you'll be back in the minority and it ain't gonna be that fun.
Hey everybody, it's Doug Collins. Welcome back. We're on a Friday. We got a lot of things we want to talk about. Been going a lot, so I just wanted to catch back up here on a Friday stuff. James cannot be with us today, unfortunately, but James will be back with us as we get some stuff going later on. It's been a crazy week. I mean, if you look at what's happening in the world, you have the State of the Union, which we'll just start off there. The State of the Union has become a political tool, and it's not anymore of a discussion about the State of the Union, you know, or where we're actually at, but it has become over the years, and this is both under Republican and Democrat presidents, a political tool. It's just become a, hey, here's what our wish list is. For Democrats, it's become more and more of a vision of here's what we'll give you and to make you happy. And what's really interesting and to this perspective on this, for this Friday take, is before we get into some other stuff, I got a couple of sort of newsy stuff here to deal with, and then we'll get into some fun stuff with the Super Bowl and Super Bowl ads and things like that. But Biden, the tone of the 2024 Democratic Party is turning amazingly much more toward what we would see from a populism of Donald Trump that actually Democrats talk about all the time. And it's funny to see that Joe Biden has actually, again, moving more and more to the issue of divide and conquer, if you would, to moving the country to here's the companies and the corporations and the rich who are the ones that have caused your problems. So what we do is we manufacture issues or we take real issues and we convert them into who's here is to blame. And with Joe Biden, it's not necessarily that you blame themselves for bad decisions. It's not that they want you to, that they'll take responsibility for the fact that they have an open border, that they have a failed foreign policy, that they have, that their own spending caused the inflation that is struggling for so many right now. But it's a, you know, just a bigger issue in what they want to do and how they want to do it. So, again, when you look at the speech the other night, we're not going to dig into specifics. You can go read the speech yourself. The biggest issues that I thought, though, was interesting in that he came to pick a fight. He picked a fight over the Social Security and Medicaid, and he got a willing participant from the Republicans. Now, again, have there been a lot of discussions over time by both Republicans and Democrats about the issues surrounding Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid? Yes. Okay, that's just a known fact. That has been discussed. It's been out there. Has there been any serious, and let me frame this properly, serious discussion by a member of the Republican Party, and definitely not the Democratic Party, but of actually ending Social Security or Medicare, Medicaid for the ones who are currently, you know, gaining it, or even for the even way foreseeable future? The answer is no, there's not. But what Democrats have done now for years when it comes to entitlement spending, because they realize that Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid are beneficial and frankly, life-saving for many who are currently getting them, getting those benefits, that they know that they can politicize it. And they can politicize it in the sense of, if you even mention these programs, if you even mention going after them, then you will be branded as someone who wants to, as famously was put in the TV as Paul Ryan, you know, pushing grandma in her wheelchair off the cliff. And these are just simply wrong, you know, even prospects to talk about. The interesting issue here is whereas Democrats and others don't want to talk about it, they may try to, you know, increase taxes or do whatever to maybe subsidize it for a short time. But the reality is in a short few years, it is the program itself, especially Social Security, is going to become insolvent. It just cannot continue on the way it's going right now. That doesn't mean that you stop people from getting it now. It doesn't mean that you would stop anybody who's even, you know, close to the eligibility age from getting it. But the question is what do you do about it long term? Because at some certain point in time, without a massive change, and that can include, you know, like I said, maybe massive tax increases, massive money inflows, wherever it comes from, there will come a time when the Social Security system, as we know it, has to either be subsidized further or changed. Biden is making a political decision here to go toward 2024 by saying, look, we're going to, you know, not deal with this. We're going to stick our head in the sand. We're not going to deal with these issues. And we're going to lie about the other side. Now, what Biden did was interesting enough, the night of the State of the Union was, is whether he realized, wanted to or not, I'm not sure I can give him that much credit. But if he did, he baited the Republicans into going along with him. So that now, in a debt ceiling debate, the Republicans have given away anything dealing with Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. When they all started booing and they all started yelling, you lie and all. I mean, look, calling them out for what it is, I understand. But at the end of the day, the Republicans, you know, as Biden turned it on it there, he says, well, I'm glad to see we all understand. We all agree on this. Now, you'll have some that say, well, no, we didn't agree on that. But in truth and reality, you did. Public perception is real. The State of the Union provides public perception. And when you understand the public perception, then you can actually look at where people are going, because they only click in for a minute or two, folks. You understand that. It's like, you know, podcasts, or it's like news stories. We only have a certain amount of time. And so I'm so glad that you listened to the Doug Collins podcast. Glad that you're with us today on the What's a Friday Best show. But understand, this is something that Republicans have got to get better on. And looking at it, but I'm glad to see that some that they're fighting back. They just got to fight on it. They got to fight back in ways that will actually not only win the political battle now, but win the honest battle going forward, as we understand these programs have the biggest consequence on our federal budget. Folks, over 80% of our monies that we spend as a federal budget, which we're already borrowing on, come from these programs. If you don't think that that is an issue, that needs to be looked at so that we can sustain these programs and we can have them go on for generations to come, then you're just sticking your head in the sand and you're playing politics and being the worst kind of politician out there. And that is one that simply lies to the American people about what is actually happening, what you can actually do about it. So as we look further into this, you know, the State of the Union, it was interesting to me, though, that the State of the Union, and this just came out, was one of the worst viewed State of the Unions in the last, I think, 40 years was what I'd heard, something like that. Worst viewed. In other words, nobody wanted to watch it. And I think at a certain point in time, people are just tired. As much as the House, I mean, the Democrats don't want to admit it, people just are not interested in Joe Biden. He's not a compelling character anymore. He's not a compelling speaker. I mean, he's, to me, it's almost like NASCAR. You know, you watch NASCAR start and finish, and you know, who see who wins, who starts. And at some point in time, you might be watching to see when they're going to wreck. And that's just a sad state of affairs. But people are watching Joe Biden to see if he's going to mess it up. And he did that royally, even starting in the first of the speech. The president of the United States should not be misspeaking when he says that Chuck Schumer is the minority leader of the United States Senate, when he's clearly the majority leader in your own party. It's not like you didn't know this person. And it's not like you didn't serve in the Senate for almost 40-something years. So as you deal with this, you know, as we look back on the State of the Union, it's just coming back more and more that people are tuning out of this administration. They're tuning out. My concern bigger is that they're tuning out of government in general. And this is leading to the problems that we're seeing in civil discourse and non, getting things done. And, the struggles that we're having around, people believing anything that comes from a government, from elections to investigations to anything else. People are just not in that position of saying, hey, we want to be a part of, being, we're not going to take a part in it. So they're turning out. That, folks, is scary, because when good people turn away from politics, when good people turn away from caring about good candidates, when good people turn away from on both sides of the aisle, when you turn away from actually participating in the system, then it is America that suffers, because you will get the only ruled by the governed and the extremes of both ideologies. And at a certain point in time, you have to be able to get things done in a diverse society. This State of the Union, I think, needs to go back to what the, basically the vagueness of the Constitution. It says from time to time they'll give a report, the executive branch to Congress. Maybe just write it up on a 2x5 piece of, post-it board and send it up to the Congress and let them read it themselves. That's what actually used to happen. They would, if you don't know the history of this, they would actually read. The president would send a report literally up to Congress, and they would read it before the bodies. It was Woodrow Wilson who actually decided to go and give the State of the Union in person, and it's progressed since then. One of the interesting parts of the State of the Union is that Ronald Reagan was the first person, if you will never have any sort of presidential trivia, one of the first was the first president to actually bring a guest and call on that guest in the State of the Union, which has become now a staple for every State of the Union. You've got to have guests. You've got to point out your people that you brought to make your political point. And Reagan did it with one of the first responders who responded to the Air Florida disaster, where the plane crashed shortly after taking off from Washington National Airport. And he had them there. They've been a fixture ever since. But at the end of the day, is the State of the Union really telling us about the State of the Union? No. Is the State of the Union really telling us anything about what actually could be accomplished? Probably not. But what it is doing is it's providing 70-something minutes this week of free political airtime to the sitting president to give a speech. And that's really, the where we're at with it. But it is interesting to me now that more and more people are not watching the speech, which, again, puts our discourses more into an interesting term, because people, I think, are just turning more and more off of an administration that just doesn't seem to have a good grip of reality where it comes to the economy, or it comes to immigration, or it comes to anything else. So the 2024 cycle is started. Even though the President Biden has not decided if he's going to run or not, he's still floating that idea out there. The problem is the Democrats have no bench. So seeing where they go from here will be an interesting time. I have a serious story before we get into some other things, and that is a story that is just, folks, if you've got kids and you have them in school, and they're school-age kids, maybe they're young, they're teenagers, please, please stay involved in their life. There's so much chaos going on right now. There's so many things that are going on in schools that you need to be involved in. And, the question is, there's a part of being involved in your child's life and being a part of what they're doing that, gives them support without, smothering them. And, we all hear the term helicopter parents and all that. But there is, a place for being involved in your life, because right now what our teenagers are going through is so different with social media, with interactions, that it is just different. And I don't care how you look at it, how you think about it, it is just different. And a story that's that came out this past few days is one out of the New York Post. It was about a 14-year-old New Jersey high school student took her own life after a video was posted in which she was at school and four girls just came up and basically started beating her and getting into a fight. They videotaped it. And then from the understanding is, here's what's even scarier about this, is that these girls do this a lot, and they do these, they pick fights and they get in fights with people, beat them up, and they show the videos on social media. How this is acceptable on social media, I have no idea. How this is actually staying up, I have no idea. If you have Twitter and Facebook and all these others taking down, and YouTube and others taking down former presidents' information and still allowing, dictators and terrorists to have, these accounts, how are we taking and not having this stuff taken down? This has no redeeming, no social value when you just have people picking a fight in a class, in a high school. Understanding this, like I said, they have done this before. But the school didn't even, you know, call the police about this. But this young lady, unfortunately, after it was put on to social media, where it was shown, she was embarrassed. And this sweet life was taken from us way too early, simply because you had idiots at a school and an administration that is even worse, that allows this undoubtedly to continue to go on as it was reported. Why do we do this? What is the fascination, folks? You have a young girl who took her own life because she was embarrassed, because she had gotten a video posted of her getting beat up on a fight that she didn't provoke. She didn't even, you know, come into contact with. They threw the story reads that they think it's fun to attack people. And, you know, and what they did was the video shows several students punching and kicking the young lady, pulling her hair and hitting her with a water bottle as she walked with her boyfriend in a school hallway. In the 20-second clip, they went ahead and said, "That's what you get, you stupid." And then words I'm not going to repeat here. He said, "Others can be heard laughing. They think it's fun to attack people and take videos." You know, I do have a question here. It says that what hurt her was the embarrassment, humiliation, noting that she's only 98 pounds and 5'2". My daughter actually blacks out, and they don't call an ambulance. Three girls were charged with third degree felony assault and a fourth charge of disorderly conduct after it was reported. Citing school policy, said the police were not called. "I don't believe a police report was done. We normally just suspend. If a parent wants to press charges, they can with the police." So again, we don't have the school pressing charges here. Facebook, he posted images of the assault, and the message explained he had to take my daughter covered in blood to the local police station. You know, how this continues to get posted on social media and how this gets to be out there is just beyond me. And then the question that for Berkeley Township, you know, in the school system is, why do they not, you know, are they not care? They have to know this is going on. And yet young lady is now dead because of lack of, you know, all you have to do is put it to lack of concern by this school system that they're not doing anything over this bullying. I do have a concern here. She's walking with her boyfriend. I'm not sure what happened there. Why there wasn't help? Why didn't anybody come to it? That leads me to my second question, is why doesn't people come to help, you know, in situations like this? I know it's easy to watch, and sometimes it's better just to stay out of things. But, you know, if we want to continue to see our young people not put into these positions and social media amplifying it. And look, I am the same way. When I was growing up, you have fights, people get in fights, and then, you know, especially as a lot of our guys, we get in a fight, you know, 10 minutes later, everything was fine. Girls get in fights, you know, go. We didn't have social media to put it on. We didn't have the keyboard warriors out there in the world. And I think this is just aggravating this situation more and more. So, you know, look, love on your kids, be a part of their lives. School system, let's stop this. This is just ridiculous that this is even allowed. And folks, especially if you see situations like this, instead of filming it, you know, why didn't somebody help here? Again, if we allow the bullies to run the world, the bullies will run the world. And this is just a sad, sad statement as we go. Now, transitioning to a little bit of interesting, folks, for those who are listening on our podcast, and you know the Fridays, we try to find some interesting, and unfortunately, I wish James could speak with us today, but we're not going to do it, so I'm having to do it myself. But the Super Bowl is this weekend, Kansas City, Philadelphia, getting ready for the battle. I think late money is going to go on Kansas City. I think the Mahomes is back healthy. And we'll just see how Philadelphia handles it. Although Philadelphia's got a good ball club, Hurts is playing best. They got a good defense. We'll see if they can actually contain Mahomes. Now, he just won the MVP award again for the second time, one of the youngest to ever do that. He's hard to control. And the question is will the defense on the Kansas City side actually hold Hurts into a way in which could allow Kansas City to stay, you know, in the game and this be a close game? I know there's a lot of folks out there thinking, "Hey, it's going to be a low-scoring affair." I don't think so. I think, although I've had some, you know, if they said bet the over, bet the under. I think I'm going to bet the over on this one. I think it may start out slow, but I do believe that both these teams could get out and actually start rolling as we go. But Super Bowl, we can talk about all we want. Super Bowl, is going to be a fun game. Going to be on Fox this weekend. Look forward to you watching it. But I'm getting to the real issues. So what are the real issues? Super Bowl number one is, who's the halftime show? It's Rihanna. Rihanna's doing the halftime show. I'm hoping this will be a good show. They're not trying to, you know, put multiples out there, it looks like they did last year. Rihanna's got some great stuff that will be, I think, great for this show. So we'll see how this, turns out. But I'm excited, you know, at least for the Rihanna halftime. We'll see how that goes. But then the one thing that even non-football players like, and I started learning this about 20-something years ago, 30-something years ago, people started watching the Super Bowl, and they have parties and they have people over. And instead of the Super Bowl is one event in which the people stay for the commercials. And so I thought it'd be pretty funny today, just talk about a few of the commercials, you know, back then. Now, we've seen some back in the late 90s and early 2000s with the dot-com bubble, where they're spending their entire ad budget on one video, you know, like Pets.com and Jeeves and all these that were literally spending $2 million, $3 million just to have one 30-second ad. And, of course, these companies were going out of business pretty quick. But people talk about these commercials. And what is interesting is nowadays is back in the day, movie stars and song singers and all would never associate themselves with products or other stuff like that for the most part. But now you have Super Bowl ads being cut with folks like Steve Martin and Ben Stiller and Serena Williams. And it's just going to be a lot coming out. So look for some of the commercials coming out this weekend. Some of the ones, though, that just stick out in my mind are the Budweiser commercials. Remember the Budweiser commercials, the frogs? I mean, these became national icon symbols, you know, the Budweiser frogs, you know, and you still laugh about them. And they become classic commercials that put in brands in people's heads that they don't get away from. And they typically will debut these at the Super Bowl. So we're looking forward this year. Doritos has got a couple of good ads coming up. They're funny ads. I've had a chance to preview them. I was talking about them on TV earlier. And one about their new poppable corn, also with Jack Harlow, is one on the Doritos and the shape of music. It's pretty funny. Pepsi's on board again with Steve Martin, Ben Stiller. A lot of these have the Breaking Bad team is part of the Doritos ad in one of those. So, again, a lot of things out there, reason to stick through. Make sure you get your snacks. Make sure you go to the bathroom. Do all those kind of things. The ads should be pretty good, you know, going forward this year. One of the ads, though, that's always mentioned is Budweiser. And Budweiser always does a lot of good ads. You see the Clydesdales ads, you've had the frogs, you've had this. But PETA, again, reading the room, folks, you know, PETA, you pick some of the strangest battles, and PETA is actually after Budweiser now because they are claiming that the trimming of the tails of the Clydesdales is some kind of damaging to the horse. PETA, if you would spend more time working with true animal issues and making sure that there is not the mistreatment of animals in the truest sense. And instead of doing some of the things that they do, probably would get a lot more attention. But picking on the Budweiser Clydesdale at the Super Bowl, I think we call that misreading the room. And you know what? That's why we have Friday Realities. That's why we have the Friday Reality Check. We've had the best of, funny of, lots of stuff going on. Be ready for the Super Bowl. We'll have a lot of discussion about it maybe next week. But the ads are coming. And folks, remember, reality calls us to love those around us and be a part of it. If nothing else today, take the time to have this weekend. Hope you have a great time with your family, great time with your friends. And we will see you again on the Doug Collins Podcast.
Hey folks, MyPillow is excited to bring to you their biggest bedding sale ever. For a limited time, you're going to get the Giza Dream bed sheets for as low as $29.98, a set of pillowcases for only $9.98, and rejuvenate your bed with a MyPillow mattress topper for as low as $99.99. $99.99, get a mattress pillow topper. Look, they come in all sizes. They got all kinds of stuff. Blankets, they've got duvets, they've got quilts, they got comforters, they got body pillows, they got bolster pillows, they got all at big, big discounts. And also, they're extending their money-back guarantee for Christmas until March 1, 2023, making them the perfect gift for your friends, your family, and for everyone you know. Folks, and just from a personal note here, I have the Giza Dream Sheets. They're on my bed right now. I slept on them last night. Some of the best sheets that we and Lisa and I have ever owned. They are worth, I mean, at this price, they're a steal. My wife and I have bought bed sheets, linens, at much higher cost. It's supposedly much higher quality. These from MyPillow are at the highest of quality, and at a price like this, you can't beat it. So go now to MyPillow.com, use promo code Collins, C-O-L-L-I-N-S, or call 1-800-986-3994, and you'll get huge discounts on all the MyPillow bedding products, including the Giza Dream bed sheets for as low as $29.98, and get all your shopping done while qualities last. And remember, put in that promo code Collins for these discounts.